from PowerTech engineering. Okay, we have people who are building these, Mr. Vijayaraman and Ms. Rajam. They are both hardcore engineers, so you must take pity on us who are not and explain it in a way we can understand, which I'm sure they will do. So they're going to share their experience from desalination plant put in Chennai, which is just next to the ocean, I think. And we are going to find out. I'm going to find out along with you.
Good afternoon to everybody. We are from PowerTech Engineering Private Limited from Chennai. I am Vijayaraman. My co-author is Ms. Rajam. We want to explain about our experience in operating the 100 MLD desalination plant located on the northern side of Chennai. This is one of the largest power plant
largest plant
in India, set up more than 10 years back. Now the second plant also set up in south of Chennai. There are two more plants coming in Chennai now, 150 MLD and another 400 MLD that is also tendered by the Chennai Metro Water, and it is going to come in due course. We want to share our experience. Next slide.
This power plant, our experience.
Yeah, see, we were involved in the 100 MLD desalination plant from the
Lenders Engineering stage.
lender engineering stage up to O&M. Now also we are doing the supervision of the O&M activity. We were involved during the engineering execution and construction in the O&M stage also.
Excuse me, I just want to explain to the audience, for those who don't know, OMM, O and M is operations and maintenance.
Yes.
Yes. Next slide. These are the salient features of the plant.
This plant, the construction area is around 33 acres, and the treated cost will be around 50 rupees per kiloliter. The power consumption will be around 3.51 kilowatt hour per meter cubed. So then
You can
the
divide that by 80 to get it in euros. Sorry, I'll just butt in from the
Okay. Coming into the design details, the seawater intake quantity will be around 238 MLD, and the
100 MLD.
for and the outlet will be the 100 MLD. So what the recovery ratio is 45%. The balance will be the reject. 55% will be reject. So the quality of the seawater is displayed on the screen, and the quality of treated water will be around the TDS will be restricted to 500 ppm. Then alkalinity 200 ppm, hardness, pH, turbidity, boron will be less than 1. So this is based on IS standard. This is the basic scheme what we are doing in a 100 MLD desalination plant. Here, what is this? We can divide into four stages: seawater intake, pre-treatment, main treatment, and comes the post-treatment. Then seawater intake. Here we have followed the flood and a sink method. Here, then comes the pre-treatment. In pre-treatment, we are removing the suspended particles by screening, pressure self-filtration, Catrich filters, and then comes the RO system. Here in the RO system, as we all know, that we are separating the salt from the seawater. And as Sid clearly said, that in order to reduce the power consumption, we have adapted the pressure of this brine reject as an input to the isobaric pressure exchanger. So in isobaric pressure, okay. Then in RO system, there will be high pressure pumps, RO system, isobaric pressure exchanger. From the high pressure pumps, 45% of the seawater will be injected into the RO system. The balance, 55% will be injected through the isobaric chamber, which utilizes the pressure of this brine water. We are using the pressure as a drive force.
Dr. Rajam, how would you say that to a common person? That is, you know, you're, when you say pressure, there's some sort of a machine that puts it at a high speed. What happens actually?
Okay. Let me explain that the brine reject will be around 58 bar pressure.
Okay.
So the high pressure pump inlet pressure to the RO system will be around 60 bar. I'm just telling like a common.
Okay.
So that 58 bar pressure will be used as a driving force to inject the seawater back to the system.
Energy recovery device.
That is
okay.
The outlet pressure, madam. We want to utilize, we are putting into the inlet again, and we want to take advantage of the existing pressure.
Okay.
So here is the energy recovery device.
Got it.
That okay. Yellow color.
Energy recovery device. This is the inlet. This is the inlet to the reverse osmosis system. Here we are injecting wide high pressure pump 45% of the seawater. The balance seawater will be entering to the energy recovery device. It is a pressure exchanger. Okay.
Okay.
So through this exchanger. By recovering the pressure from the brine that is reject of the RO system, this pressure will be used at injected at inlet, which is used as a inlet to the energy recovery device.
Converting this.
Okay. The seawater. The seawater will be entering this 55%. The pressure will be. Brine pressure will be entering this side around 58 bar. So with this pressure, we are pumping the 55% of the seawater to the reverse osmosis system using the booster pump. Okay.
Okay.
It is nothing but a pressure exchanger, utilizing the pressure of the brine water and supplying it to the inlet of the reverse osmosis system. By means of this, here the power consumption will be 3.51 kilowatt hour per meter cubed.
In case if it is not there, it will be doubled.
If this pressure recovery device is not here, the power consumption will be doubled.
Got it. Of energy. So
So this. Okay. So
the cost of production is getting reduced to almost half, madam, except for the capital cost. The
Got
power
it.
Consumption cost. It is getting reduced.
Yeah, just through to using pressure. That's interesting. So this is another way of using pressure. And so the brine comes out through the rejected outlet, is it?
Yes.
And then the that's outlet at the other end is where you can get potable water, is it?
Yes.
Okay. So got it.
Okay.
Please continue.
This is the model of seawater intake. So this is the flood and sink method, where we all know that the pipe.
Madam, Bay of Bengal, we are having two cyclones season, and putting any pipeline is a Herculean task.
Near
Chennai. So this pipeline also, the entire project got delayed because of this seawater intake pipeline laying only. There are two methods. They can do either dredging and put the pipe below the seabed, or they can lay the pipe over the bed by putting the concrete counter blocks. They have adopted the second method, what is shown in the sketch. Because in near Bay of Bengal coast, the lateral drift is always towards north. This plant is located next to a harbor. This pipeline fortunately not affected much after laying, otherwise the bed movement will be always about, variation is even 1 meter from one season to another season. To take care of this, only HCP pipeline is put along with the chlorine dosing pipeline.
Yes.
Okay.
and they have taken beyond the surf zone. And inside the plant, it is GRP pipe is used. The diameter of the pipe for HDPE is 1600. And they have gone more than 500 meter.
The minimum distance kept between the intake and outfall pipe will be minimum 500 meter in order to not to mix the brine water with the intake feed water.
Got it.
Yeah.
Got it. So this is very interesting. So it is there out on the beach, is it? Like this?
Yeah.
This is the time-consuming thing.
Because the calm period is available is from February to April only, madam. During that period, they have to lay the pipe.
Right, right. Absolutely.
It's very rough.
Absolutely.
Then these are the treatments involved. Screening, pre-treatment, then reverse osmosis system, post-treatment. Post-treatment is nothing but we are remineralizing the desalinated water because most of the mineral will be lost in reverse osmosis. So we are remineralizing the treated water.
Okay.
Filtration.
This is very interesting. Sidd is also mentioning that you have to remineralize because water is so pure that it becomes, it has to be remineralized.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Rana. I will ask your question. Okay. Please continue. What is flocculation? What is that?
It is in seawater, there will be suspended particles and colloidal particles. Hmm. In order to remove those particles, we are using the coagulant chemical, like ferric chloride, some chemicals.
Okay. Prepared.
So, using that chemicals, we are coagulating. We are making it as a bulk material, colloidal particles to a bulk, and we are allowing them to settle in the clarifiers.
Okay.
Okay. Further, they are treated in the sand filters and cartridge filters.
So this is also one of the end of life waste that is generated in this system, or can it be repurposed in any way? All this coagulated.
No, it is only a sludge.
Okay, sludge. Yeah, got it. Yeah. And how many households or how many? What is the population that can be for which water can be made accessible with this kind of a large plant?
It is around
100 million liters. This is not only supplying the public household users. It is also going industry for industries also.
Okay.
Power plant. Yeah, okay. Power plant. North Chennai power plant. They are getting water from this desalination plant, madam. And then Vallur power plant also, apart from the industry also. How much percentage they are giving to industry?
Approximately.
Around 30% is going to industry, 70% to the Chennai population, madam. North Chennai, they are getting this water.
So how many people would that be? Because it's interesting that it's going to power plant also for which water is very much necessary. So what would be the population that gets water because of this? The 70%, how many households? 100,000, what is it? 1,000, 10,000?
It will be about more than a million.
Yes.
We will come back.
More than a million people. Yeah, okay. Yeah. That's very interesting. What's the population of Chennai, sir?
It will be around 6 million.
6 million.
Now it's about 7.5 million.
Okay.
Okay. And I'll just give two contexts. See, Chennai requires more than 1,000 million liters per day, of which say, Chennai Metro is able to provide about 700 MLD, of which PowerTech is managing 100 MLD through its role as owner's engineer. And other sources are very limited. Sorry,
got
sir,
it.
Please continue.
Please continue, sir. Then try to wind up because we are going to have some question sessions also, but please continue.
Okay.
First question.
As already explained, then comes the reverse osmosis. Here, the basic concept of osmosis, as everyone knows, that the dilute solution will all the water from the dilute solution will move to the concentrated solution side. In reverse osmosis, we are going to apply pressure on the concentrated solution side so that water will be separated from the high concentrated solution side to the lower concentrated solution side. So this is the concept used in reverse osmosis. So in common speaking, here through the semipermeable membrane, we are allowing only water to pass through the membrane, and this salt will be rejected as a brine. This is the
concept.
Okay. Then comes the post treatment. As already said, it is remineralization of the treated water.
For human consumption.
For human consumption.
Yes. Okay.
And also disinfection.
Okay.
Okay. So,
see, some of the problem faced in the during the operation of the plant, we have highlighted here. One is about the erection of the seawater intake and outfall pipeline in the rough sea. Because in the seawater intake, we are facing three problems. One is corrosion, biofouling, and then the turbidity. These are the three things we have to face. The second thing is the O-ring of the RO pressure vessel. Yeah. That you can explain more.
That O-ring leakage, it is due to two factors. Due to sudden tripping of the pressure, high pressure pumps, there will be movement between the membranes, which causes the O-rings to break up. And next comes the aging of the O-rings. So this problem due to the movement of the O-rings can be minimized by using high abrasion resistant O-rings. And also, in order to avoid leakage, we can check and periodically maintain and replace the O-rings accordingly.
The third problem what we are facing in the plant is, madam, GRP pipe. They made fittings. So these fittings joints, they made with FRP, that fibers, yes, with resins. That is prone to leaking frequently because the pipes are kept above ground. They were not able to provide any thrust block. Whenever there is any power shutdown or any water hammer problem, that time the joints are breaking and leaking, that is becoming a perennial problem.
Yes.
In some other plant is on the southern side, they used the HCB pipeline that is functioning satisfactorily. This is one of the lessons learned.
This is very interesting. This would be a good moment to introduce Dr. Rana's question. He says that also HDPE pipes, they also become brittle, which means that they may not leak, but probably, I guess, they might break. I don't know if there is a cyclone. So he's asking, is there any specific reason to use those HDPE pipes in exposed condition to transfer seawater? Did you have any problems? Because they are, I don't see it in your problem.
No, in the south, the southern side of the Chennai, there is another 100 MLD plant. They have used HDPE pipe already 6 years over, madam. There is no problem.
Okay. Okay. So, yeah. Thank you. Please continue.
Yeah.
Okay. In RO membranes, this is based on the life of the RO membrane. The RO membrane will function well if it is properly maintained. Maintaining is the major thing, and chemical cleaning, regular chemical cleaning. Without this, we cannot expect the performance of the RO membranes will be 100%, because in due course of time, there will be organic fouling, colloidal fouling, and biofouling, scaling will be there. So periodic maintain is important for RO membrane performance to do well.
This is one of the key maintenance area, ma'am.
So how many people are involved in the maintenance in such a plant? What's the staff number?
Approximately 10 to 15 people will be there, sir.
Okay. We need to wind up now to give some time for the questions. I just want to tell you, sir and madam.
Okay. Just these are the other two plants where we were involved, madam.
Okay.
So then I'm going to ask some basic questions that has come. I would suggest, then I would throw the floor open. Nuki from Nigeria, he had asked this last time also. Once the water comes out, what is the arrangement for the distribution of water to the households? Does it go by the municipality pipes, or do you have any other system from the outlet? How does it reach the household or to the industry? What is the system?
The treated water is stored in a tank. They are supplying through the municipal authority only, municipal pipeline.
Municipal pipeline, it goes to the, okay. Yeah. So it's not due to private, it goes through the
not
municipal pipeline. Is. Okay.
As of now, it is government only distributed.
Okay, thank you. You can stop sharing for a minute. I will just throw the floor open. Dr. Rana, do you want to ask any questions? Jean-Pierre, do you have any questions? Anybody else in the audience? Okay, Nuke, you got one second to ask a question. Go on.
Okay. My question, you've said that you transmit this water to the people through the pipeline, but I also want to let you understand that if there's any way that the company should be working with the government, because I have this problem with how safe is the water that the people are drinking? How safe is the water? We've gone through all this process, it's beautiful. We've been able to produce a better water, it's beautiful. I like also give you an example. I was somewhere in Asaba and I bought a sachet water. And then something came upon me and I said, this is a treated water. Assuming if I keep this water for like 1 month, 2 months, 6 months, 8 months, there's no expiry date on it. And then after 6 months or 8 months, maybe I happen to drink this water. Is this water still safe? Is what I want to know after passing through all this process and then the chemical content of purifying this water. How safe is it at that point?
Okay,
that being with the people without any expiring date.
So I'll just re-put it in a way because I don't know if they got it, but because they don't know the system of sachet. Can I explain, Nuke?
Okay.
So what happens in many African countries? And you see, or even to private companies, you see, water comes out, it is then bottled. And in Africa, it's put in sachets, plastic sachets. Sachets of water are very common. Okay. So Nuke is asking, after how, on the plastic sachets, there's no expiry date. So he's asking, how long will the potable water that comes out, okay, how long will it be safe?
Not having any duration.
Not sure. Not sure.
You can tell me. Rajan will tell you.
Depending upon the quality of the plastic material used, ma'am.
Oh, very interesting. So, depending on the quality of the... And then I will ask one question that Jean-Pierre had got. Jean-Pierre, si vous me permettez, he was saying that in countries like India with high temperature, he is saying that if the water goes through a lot of pipes through the households and the pipes are not in good condition, won't there be problems?
No, as of now,
we have not. Most of the pipes are buried pipe, madam. It's not above ground.
So the transportation time between the time it comes out from the plant and the time it reaches a household, how long is it?
Within a day.
Within a day, madam.
Within a day. Because these were the things. Okay, now does... Dr. Rana, why don't you show your face? Your question is very interesting. Why don't you ask yourself? Otherwise, I'll ask for you. Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Very good evening. Can you hear me?
Yes, very clearly.
First of all, thank you for excellent presentation. Quite very insightful. The question what I was trying to understand, you mentioned in the presentation that water quality you are supplying for both domestic as well as the industrial requirement, power requirement. And what I understand, the water requirement for domestic or drinking purpose is different. That is BIS 10050. And quality requirement for industrial will be different.
Yeah.
So are you supplying same quality of water for both for drinking purpose as well as for industrial purpose? If not, is there some mechanism that you manage the quality of water for different purposes?
No, sir.
Industrial will go further. They will do their...
Based on their based on the industrial requirement, they will further treat the water supply to them.
Okay, see, it will be treatment will be done by the power unit, not by yourself,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Okay, got it. Thank you very much. And the other earlier question, which ma'am has already requested and you have answered about SDP pipeline. What happens, like, if you see the, like, technical material, SDP pipe, they are not recommending exposed condition. So what happens, like, in the temperature condition, when it is exposed to sunlight, pipe becomes brittle. So maybe that initially 5 years, 6 years, 10 will serve, but it's not going to long for 15 years, 20 years. So there are a lot of other alternative pipe material available, like especially for sea area, which is corrosion resistant, GRP pipe material, and maybe line pipe material. So I'm quite interested to know that why specifically we have used the SDP pipe, because I haven't seen SDP pipe used such a large scale in exposed condition anywhere. That's the reason I was very interested to know more detail about that.
Sir, it's a seawater intake pipe. On the seaward side, they have used it for the summer in portion, HDPE pipe. On the landward side, they have GRP used pipe. GRP pipe.
But seaward side is like exposed condition, right?
It is below the water.
It is submerged.
Okay, but figure, sir, whatever figure we are showing.
This is at the time of laying. The main.
Okay. Got it.
Kept on the seashore and pushed it into the sea.
Methodology adopted.
Yeah.
Okay. No, that answers my query. Thank you.
That just for our economic students, because we are so obsessed about governance, I just want to ask one question. Are there any regulatory measures, put by the state government or by the national government that you have to adhere to any quality standards? Or
yes,
is there water. Any? Is there any with respect to water?
Portable water you are talking about?
Portable water or for treatment of waste, the brine. Is there any regulation as of now?
I'll answer my question if you permit, ma'am.
I work with
Central Pollution Control Board, and which is the apex for having standards all over India. And the Central Pollution Control Board, they have the Act, Environmental Act, which describes the drinking water quality, which is also has been adopted by the BIS. Yeah. So BIS 1050.
Bureau of Industrial Standards.
Yes,
okay.
Yes, ma'am. So we have both. And similarly, for industrial water requirement also, CPCB has described different testing for different kind of industry. If you have textile industry, if you have tenant industry, what kind of water requirement is very clearly defined.
Then for the waste produced, is there but we will put this in the general discussion, because I want to ask this to Sid also. I want to, there is something known as producer's responsibility. So please, Dr. Anna, join me in that, because I want to know what in the different countries, what is the responsibility of the producer in terms of treatment of waste. Okay. But now we'll thank you so much, Dr. Rajam and Mr. Vijayaraman.